Thanks for attending. My focus today is nutrition for women and optimizing fat loss and body composition goals. I've broke this down into 6 components. 1, body composition. 2, metabolism. 3, nutritional guidelines. 4, macro options. 5, possible medical complications. 6, a summary. And then I have case studies sprinkled throughout to illustrate the points of each topic. The first thing is body composition. At my office, we have a bod pod. It's that egg-shaped like chamber that measures somebody up to 500 pounds. It's air displacement. There's 3 right now that I hold the candle to. It's underwater weighing. You got DEXA, which is also known for bone density, and you got the bod pod. And there's actually a new one surfacing to keep your eyes and ears out for. It's by Sika. So I'm going to talk to the rep next week just to find out more about it. Not that I need another body composition piece of equipment, but it's nice to know that there might be something out there. Now, for me, when you're working with your individuals, whether they're athletes or non-athletes, is that this is huge, in my opinion. If you're working with somebody on their health, is what their body composition is. It's a scientific way. It's not a body mass index way. So it's when I know how much percent body fat they are, and then I dissect how much lean weight that is, and this is really important, is most people just look at percent body fat. You need to break this down and look at how much lean weight does that mean for that individual. And so I go by 1 gram, I go for 1 gram of protein per pound of lean weight. And because I do have this technology, I can get, I can make sure that my clients are getting that need. If obviously this is almost a $50,000 piece of equipment, so most people aren't going to go out and purchase this or buy a DEXA. DEXA is over 100 grand and underwater weighing, that's a headache just because you've mentioned water. So if you do skin fold calipers, I highly recommend you buy the scientific version, the Lang calipers, or if there's another brand out there that I'm not aware of. I can get within 3% on the leanest person. So I'm also a master assessor of the state for the state of Ohio for wrestling. So this is the time of the year. In a couple of weeks, we'll do skin fold calipers. So this is where I can do bod pods and skin fold calipers. So I know I'm 3% off on the scientific version, doing it as many times as I can to get them within millimeters. So I have that data. The other thing is again, if you don't have Lang calipers and you want to do body composition, the other one that I find that's pretty decent is a Tanita scale, but the Tanita scale that tells you this percent how hydrated someone is. Because if you just hold something out and that's bioimpedance, it measures how fast the current runs through. So water is metabolically active, so the more hydrated you are, the faster the current goes through. If you're dehydrated, the slower the current goes through. So with the Tanita, at least it will tell you if you buy, it's about $300 to $400 for this scale. It's not a $100 scale. So if you have a $100 scale, it's probably not telling you the percent hydration. And I found, again, I only have 10 people to test this off of, but they had the Tanita scale with the percent hydration, and they were within 3 to 4%, which is usually pretty, that's actually pretty good. So if you're investing in that. If you're working with athletes, it's a means to better athletic performance, usually if you can maximize their body composition. Now, this is a chart by the American Council of Exercise. I tend to go with athletes for women. I usually go 18 to 22%, but you can see it can go lower. My biggest thing, if you try to go lower with a female athlete, please make sure they have a normal menstrual cycle normally. If they lose a menstrual cycle due to too low body fat, then you're putting them at risk of bone loss. So there's a direct correlation with if they lose, if they don't have a normal menstrual cycle, especially due to low body composition or not eating enough calories, they're going to lose bone. For my male athletes, I usually range for 8 to 12%, but if you work with offensive linemen or that type of, different sports, then obviously the average offensive lineman in the NFL is 26% body fat. The average offensive lineman in the college ranks is over 30% body fat. So you picture 300 pounds and 100 pounds of fat, and they can still move it, which is pretty amazing. But 20 to 25% of those 18-year-olds already are showing signs of heart disease. So if you happen to be working with them, they're big early. So my goal is to always try to get them when they're 14 and 15 so I can start exchanging fat for muscle. And you can put an average once they're in puberty. A guy can put on a half to 1 pound of muscle a week when they're in puberty. And they're in puberty until about 22 to 24. So that's why they always have an advantage in college, because the strength coaches usually go, oh, we can put on weight. Well, that's because that's the highest amount of growth hormone and testosterone they're ever going to have in their whole entire life. So for your football players or your athletes and collegiate males, they have a benefit there, and they can maximize that. So if you put the nutrition and stuff together, it maximizes. Now, for my average population, if I can keep my females 30% or lower, I feel from type 2 diabetes, high cholesterol, those types of things, they're probably going to live a pretty healthy life, knock on wood. And my guys, I try to keep at 20, but you notice this chart says 25, but there's another chart out there that says 20, and I go with the 20%. And I do not discriminate against age. So I don't give my people who are older a grace to have a higher body fat. The average person will lose, after age 30, a half to 2 pounds of muscle a year if they don't do something to maintain that. So I tell you, the true fountain of youth is lean weight. And you have to know their body composition. So if you're successful, you're successful also if they maintain lean weight by the time the year is over. So there is some success in just maintenance of lean weight versus being the person who's continuing to lose lean weight every year. And that's going to create a lot of havoc on the body. So just knowing those numbers and what you're going to shoot for. Now, this was a girl that was 18% body fat when she came in. But just to let you know, if I just went by percent body fat, oh, you're fine. But she wanted to put on more muscle weight. This is one where she put on 10 pounds. We did the bod pod prior. We did menu planning, all of that. But this just shows that she was really excited, because a lot of people don't just want to get fatter. They want to know what is changing. So this just reiterated, she was so excited. It excelled her performance. But again, it's a measurement tool. And this is not just looking at body fat. This is a collegiate women's basketball player who kind of, maybe you've known, met somebody in this situation. But she took something a little bit too far. She started eating a little bit healthier, started to see some results. Eating healthier started to trickle into, I'm going to eat a little bit less and a little bit more less. And it just went the wrong direction. And if you remember that slide, it said 14% for females, and she's at 15%. So again, if you just looked at percent body fat in her post, you would go, oh, that's great. Well, no, it's not great, because prior to that time, she had 128 pounds of lean weight, and she's lost 7 pounds of muscle. Nobody, I don't care who they are, they don't want to see muscle loss. That, if you have an eating disorder, body composition is extremely powerful. And I know there's collegiate schools out there that, oh, we're not going to do it on female athletes. I'm the opposite. It's more about what you do with the information, and sometimes you got to keep it out of the hands of the coaches. Your goal is to use it as knowledge. If you have a heavy set athlete, you don't need to tell, they know they're heavy set. It's the ones that are underweight and you're trying to show them they're putting on muscle that makes the difference. Or as women, hey, my weight's gone up, well, what is the weight? Well, it's muscle weight, so you can get them from each advantage. But this just goes to show you, when she saw that, she was kind of on the borderline of something going really bad. It helped her flip it around. Now, this is a 42-year-old female. Again, we did a body composition. She's 5'4". Body mass index, body says that she, being 5'4", she should weigh 120 plus or minus 10%. But look at how much lean weight she has at 30%. She has 117 pounds of lean weight. Lean weight is everything but fat weight, so eyeballs, hair on your head. But she was 42, so she's not going to grow 10 pounds of hair and 10 eyeballs and grow 3 more inches. So if you were somebody who was like, oh, well, body mass index, we should get you to 120, she'd be 2.5% body fat by the time that's done. So this is somebody who would never fit a body mass index, but she still clearly has too much body fat. So this is where you don't just, again, look at the number. And if I was if I'm a personal trainer and I was training somebody like this, or I'm talking to the strength coach because I'm unique and I do body composition, I some say, ooh, you need to go to your strength coach because you have a lot of lean weight. So you might not need any more. You just need to maintain. Because sometimes you can put on too much muscle. Force equals mass times acceleration. So This is a person where if you're limited on time and what you're going to focus with this individual, this person does not need to gain more muscle mass. They just need to maintain it. So you're going to change your strategy on your exercise protocol for this individual. Now, if they gain more lean weight, it could be a benefit, but it's not a necessity in this moment. And then it also helps set guidelines on what her weight truly should be because of how much lean weight she actually has. She's somebody who could weigh 150 and be under 30% body fat and be 5'4". And this is a unique one. You'll respect this. My eyes still bulge out. I have a heptathlete, Olympic athlete. She's come in for 3 years. She is 5'6", 150 pounds, and 9% body fat without trying normal menstrual cycle. She undereats. She doesn't eat enough protein. I look at her like, how in the world? But one of her coaches said her gluteus maximus was too big. I just go, oh my gosh, she's 9% body fat. Or she's 9%. She has a lot of lean weight. She doesn't need more muscle. She has almost too much muscle, but she's an Olympic athlete. She went to the Olympics. So when you have those numbers, that's how it helps you as a person to help someone better. Now, the second component is metabolism. I also do indirect calorimetry at my office. I don't use estimated. With that being said, I've done almost over 6,000 BOD pods and metabolic tests. And so I don't do research, but I can tell you that people who are active and people such as athletes themselves tend to burn more calories than what I see on the equations I was taught. Now, if I see a lower number, then a lot of times if somebody is outputting a certain amount of activity and only inputting, and there's a big gap, sometimes I'll see on our indirect calorimetry or resting metabolic rate is their metabolism is a lot lower than what it should be. And I've had people going as much activity, and what I've seen, because there's not charts out there that says, oh, you should be there. It just goes height, weight, your age, how old you are, and boom, this is what you should burn. But those equations discriminate against age. And for the most people who aren't active, they're somewhat accurate. But people who are more active, even if they're overweight, people tend to burn more calories. If they're chronically under-eating, then I can find this problem and I can rearrange that and direct them in the appropriate area that I'm trying to get them to. This is just one, she could fit the female athletic triad in a way, but she just was eating 2,100 calories, and with doing the indirect calorimetry, she was burning 27. We found that she needed at least 27 to 3,200 calories a day. She wasn't having a normal menstrual cycle. Literally, by just fixing this, she started having it back in 2 months. She's fine. She PR'd that year. She PR'd the next year after that. And so she continues on that. I will share with you, this number is very powerful for males and females, because once they know the number, sometimes they don't realize how much they actually burn. So it becomes one of those, wow, I actually need this. I was fortunate also to work with the first round draft pick for football, and we would do the indirect calorimetry, and I was telling him, you need at least 5,000 calories a day. He was consuming only 3,500 calories a day, and he had a 5% body fat via BOD pod. And I just go, and you ate like crap, and you know, the people you don't like. But what all said and done, he's like, Don, I'll do whatever you tell me. We changed all of his stuff. And he went to 4.6% body fat. That's not necessarily what I needed to accomplish, but he goes, I feel a million times better. But with this metabolism and then tracking, that's all he needed was a number to go, aha, I got it. I'm under eating. I was tracking it. You're right. And I'll do what you have to say. But he ended up going in the first round. It was pretty exciting. And he's still in the NFL, and he's still doing extremely well following the nutrition. We talk once in a while. Now, this is one I just wanted to get a point across, that the equations discriminate against age. This was a woman who was burning 1,800 calories at rest. So she slept for 24 hours a day. She was burning 1,800 calories. And this does not include daily activity. And she actually works out, you know, she was working out 5 to 6 times a week. She was 30 pounds to 40 pounds overweight, but she worked out. So this was one that she came to me or my operation because everywhere she went, they had her eating 1,200 calories because she's like 55 and she was 5'4".
So they just go, well, you need 1,200 calories. She's like, I just couldn't stick with it. And I go, well, you can't stick with it because you're burning 1,800 just at rest. So you're somebody who, if you're going to do something, you're not going to eat less than 1,800 calories a day. So it just, all of a sudden, it was something that made it measurable. And then I'm not guessing, and I have the equations, and my equations would have been off. So if you can pair up with somebody that can do this, or you do it yourself, I highly recommend it. Now, what are some tips that you, this is the third component of tips of what we can incorporate, and I've listened to a lot of talks, and I feel like I'm right there with everybody else. I feel like I might be repeating if you've gone to a lot of the nutrition talks, but breakfast is extremely important. They have found that if you eat a good, solid breakfast with a good amount of protein, 20 to 30 grams, you'll eat less later. They have found in research, this is one that if you have athletes that or people who train in the afternoon, if they skip breakfast or they eat very little, that their performance could decline up to 5% in the afternoon and evening practice or competition. And so breakfast is important. Eating every, I usually go every 3 to 4 hours. Some people, depending on what time their schedule is, I know there was one speaker that maybe there's not a difference, but there is a difference when you're looking at abdominal fat, blood sugar, cortisol, and so that all ties into glucagon, the hormone, which is a fat-burning hormone, and then that will tie into body composition. So eating more consistently, and if you just heard the previous talk, there is nutrient timing because you need so much protein every 3 to 4 hours. This is one that I always use, and I think it's a good tip for you to look for yourself and for your client bases to try to get people to eat 2/3 of their calories or energy by the time 2/3 their day is over. So if they need 3,000 units of energy and they got up at 6 and they go to bed like at 10 or 11, by 3 or 4 o'clock in the afternoon, they probably should have consumed up to 2,000 calories a day. Now, what most people do is they eat 2/3 of their calories the last 1/3 of their day. So they eat a little breakfast, they eat a light lunch, and then when do most people work, if you're working with the high school setting, they're working mainly in the afternoon. If you're collegiate, they're all over the place. But most competitions, unless it's on the weekend, is, more in the afternoon. But again, if you're working collegiate, it could be all over the place. But if you have a client base that's not athletes, they either are working out in the morning or they're working out in the afternoon unless they have the freedom in their schedules. So this is where if you can just look at what they're eating at what time and just go, oh, you do MyFitnessPal, Spark People, Lose It, whatever app, and you're just like, oh, well, how many calories are you eating? By 2/3 of your day, you're going to start seeing a lot of people struggle to eat a lot at the end of the day. And not earlier. And again, if we remember definitions, food is a calorie is heat, and heat is energy. Food, calorie, heat, heat's energy. Food, your energy source. So you almost want breakfast to be your largest meal, lunch medium, and dinner light, unless you're working out at night. So you can see there's always these individual consequences with each individual. Fiber, you can easily look at fiber, 20 to 40 grams of fiber a day, because if they're eating a lot of fiber, not through a supplement, but if they're getting it through food, then they're going to be choosing pretty darn good healthy foods. Now, if you want to make the biggest impact on cholesterol, we produce 10% of our cholesterol in our gut and 10% in our liver, it's the soluble fiber. The average American consumes only 10 to 12 grams of fiber a day, and we're asking them to consume 25 to 40 grams of fiber a day. And we really want them to focus on a minimum of 10 to 15 grams of soluble. Soluble is, we got two types of fiber. Insoluble is what most people think of, that you just kind of poop it out fast, it just in and out. Right? That's what people, oh, don't eat that. It's just, you're going to have some problems. Soluble is kind of what probably makes you pass gas, to be quite honest, because it slows down. And so if we think of spring cleaning, and we have the fast fiber, so we have the insoluble fiber, that's like vacuuming the hallway. This is like vacuuming all the empty spots, just the traffic areas, your hallway and this those pathways. But if you're doing spring cleaning, it's like you pick up every one of these chairs, you pick up behind the curtains, and you get behind the plants, and you're getting the cobwebs. That's what soluble fiber is. You've got these little things called villi, and they move the food. And if you think, it's pretty impressive that we can digest food, because it's not just straight down. It has to do all of this, and we expect it to do all of that, and we're fine.
But it has to move all of that. So soluble fiber gets into those little crevices where it actually connects with the lining, where it actually gets absorbed into the bloodstream. So this soluble fiber is extremely important for the integrity of the gut and also for the health of the gut. So that's where you really, if you're just like having them focus on fiber, because if you were here yesterday and I think his name was Adam presenting, you know, it's all about small decisions, small choices, getting people from A to B to A, you know, B to C, and progressing them. This could be an easy way to get somebody to start focusing on food choices and making better food choices. Protein, this is just redundant if you've heard all of our nutrition talks, but I will share with you, because I've done over 6,000 bod pods, that I can tell you just from the amount of lean weight, most guys fit 20 to 30 grams of protein every 3 to 4 hours, depending on who they are. If they're trying to gain muscle, there's research that shows if you drink protein before you go to bed, and if you have a competition at night, you should have some protein in the morning, but hopefully they're already doing that. It's usually 20 to 30 grams of protein. I'm usually at least 5 times a day, just because of the amount of how I string out the calories and how long their day is. Females, 16 to 24 grams, but honestly, most of them are 20, 24 grams. The 16 are kind of for my really light, underweight athletes like cross country, and they come in at 90 pounds. So then you start doing the math, you're gonna get pretty high in protein for a 90 pound cross country runner at 28 grams. So you've already heard, if you were here for the talk prior with Lisa and Mike, that I go with 2 to 3, some it's 2.5 to 3.5 grams, some it's 4 grams of leucine if they can't get that protein source in, or it's a low quality protein source, because leucine is the main amino acid that turns on that protein synthesis. So if I'm working with a vegan, almost and they're an athlete, I get complementary proteins at every meal, and I'm pushing branched chains, because usually, unless they're getting a lot of soy, they're not usually getting enough leucine throughout the day. And I've had only 5, but I've had 5 document cases where the only thing we changed was adding leucine, and they added on lean weight. So they didn't change their training, and they didn't really change their nutrition that much except for that factor. So I have 5. Now, and also you should start your protein. You should get enough protein at breakfast. This is big, and if you saw in the last speaker, Mike was pointing out how it's important to get that 20 to 30 grams of protein. So if you're working with your client base, especially non-athletes or athletes alike, this is the place where they probably have the hardest place to get the protein in. Pre and post-workouts, Lynn Kravitz did a talk last year for the NSCA, and he had some good research on if you eat a little bit before your workout, you're going to burn more fat after. So usually having a little bit before. If I'm working with somebody on glycogen storage, this is where sometimes I might just have them hydrate. If it's an only an hour workout, we might just hold off on that and then to increase glycogen storage. So please understand what makes nutrition so complicated is it always depends on what question they're trying to answer with the research. So if it says it doesn't build muscle, but it might help with recovery as far as soreness, it might not do this, but it could do that. So we always have to be cautious when we're reading research studies. So this one is, you know, just you probably for most people, they do need a little bit something, and they definitely need to hydrate, okay? Post, if it's strength training, or I always say if it's 2 hours or longer, I do like them to get 20 grams of protein, 30 to 60 grams of carbs. The biggest mistake I find with most people who don't know this and they work out is they're the ones that just do the protein and they don't do any carbs. So this is where you come in and educate them that it's really important that they get the carbs to get back into the muscle, and that there is a timing window on that for optimal absorption. And then if you have somebody who's doing maybe cardio and then they're going to strength training, the research is showing that it's probably important to get something small in between the cardio session and the strength training session. Now, this is more of my Ironman, my triathletes, where they're doing 2 to 3 hours, or maybe you're working with a collegiate athlete that's doing all this, or maybe you have an overzealous person that's doing 2 spin classes and then they're going into strength training. This is where you might have them do something. And I do have a lot of athletes that will, they're in club sports, and so they'll do all this, you know, workout, and then they'll go do strength training. So it does show that it could help with the protein synthesis to have something a little bit before that strength training workout.
Hydration, again, I feel pretty good because a lot of the speakers were on the same point, but at least half of your weight in fluid ounces a day. Technically, it should be 67%, but I don't know about you, but 67% you can walk away with knowing half of your weight in fluid ounces a day, but all of a sudden you throw in 67%, your client base is like, what? What is that? And then they have to pull out a calculator. Half of your weight in fluid ounces doesn't include activity. So when Mike was talking in the last, if you weren't here, he had it like, oh, approximately 32 ounces. But as Lisa mentioned in the last talk too, it depends on how much your people sweat. So these are guidelines, but if you want to get more scientific, they should weigh themselves before and after workouts. They don't need to know their weight. You know their weight. You're like, okay, next time if you lost a pound of fluid, you don't lose fat that fast, okay? It's not going to show up on a scale in 1 hour. It'd be nice. It'd be some more motivation to keep working out, but it's water weight. So the thing is they lost a pound, then they should have drank 16 more ounces during your workout session. You know, you don't need to emphasize weight. You're just emphasizing on what they lost. But that at that point, they need about 24 ounces. So if they left you 24 ounces that time, but the next day they work out with you, say, hey, let's try this, drink 16 more ounces. Again, it depends on how serious you want to be, where you're at with your client base. But if you're 1% dehydrated, performance can decline up to 10 to 12%. And there's research on if they're 2% dehydrated, their ability to track an object decreases by 20%. And 95% of all first movement is done by eyesight. So it's a pretty big deal. Yes, sir. It's in kilograms, so half of your weight in, it is in pounds. So if you weigh 100 pounds, it's 50 fluid ounces, okay? Pre-workout for hydration? It's hard. Proteins and carbs? No. That is all, like, what time did they eat lunch? When are they going to work out? So some of this is obviously when the workout is, how long it's going to be, and then what are you going to do with that? So, and some people don't even need a post-workout if they're going to go straight to dinner within that 30 to 40 minutes. It just depends on what they're doing. And as Mike mentioned, if you get some of that protein prior, maybe it will last through. Yeah, I think it just depends on what time of the day it is and how much I would actually recommend and how intense and how hard and what are the goals. So I wish there was a concrete answer to that, but that one's a little bit more individualized. And then I need to go back to alcohol. I could talk on hydration all day, but alcohol, so your clients who like to drink, you need to make sure, and maybe have some people who like to drink here. And so anybody who goes over two beers, two hard things of liquor, more than 8 ounces of wine, more than 24 ounces of beer, or more than 2 ounces of hard liquor, it'll impact performance up to 3 days. They will not get back to optimal for 3 days. And this means if I have a friend that's 7 foot tall and I have a friend that's 4 foot tall, because the average size liver is 2.5 pounds to 3 pounds. So my 7 foot friend does not have a 12 pound liver, and my 4 foot friend has a 1 pound liver. It's roughly 2.5 to 3 pounds. Alcohol goes to the liver, it's a toxin. Alcohol is not what's healthy. It's the grapes, it's the barley, it's the hops, but the alcohol actually is a toxin. So the minute you go over a certain amount, the liver has to process that. And it just says, oh my goodness, you just gave me way too much. And I still have to process this. Well, protein can go to the liver, carbs have to go through the liver, but you got a nice lymphatic system and fat can bypass the liver. So if you ever go to some sporting events and you see some guys with some tight bellies and you know they're not pregnant, but it looks like they're pregnant, that's because the fat is pushing out underneath the muscle and pushing it out, and that's dangerous. And alcohol loves to store in this belly and visceral fat. So keep that to 2 or less, okay? And count it as a fat, not a carb. So if you're trying to do percentages, count alcohol as a fat, okay? Everyday tips, stress. We need to make sure we keep our stress below 7. I always tell people rank their stress 1 out of 10, 10 being off the chart. If they rank it a 7 or higher, they need to keep it below that. Sometimes I've had people walk in my office and they made me stressed. I don't know if you've had that, but you're just like, I can't be around you too long. You're making me stressed just by talking because they're telling me about a jumbotron that could break down in the middle of a basketball game, but it's never happened for 20 years, but they have to be ready for that. I'm just like, and sleeping overnight? Yeah, I'm just like, okay, I think a large part of your issue is meditation and we need to work on your stress levels. Because that was affecting his whole their whole life. But increased stress, increased cortisol, decreased leptin sensitivity, increased hunger. Okay? There's a lot of stuff with cortisol. Sleep, are you asking your clients how many hours of sleep they're getting a night? If they have sleep apnea, are they using their machine? Sleep is extremely important for fat loss, muscle building, recovery. Testosterone and growth hormone release the most at night. And if you look at anybody who has kids or you remember yourself growing, what are the two things you did the most when you were going through a growth spurt? You ate and slept. You ate and slept. You ate and slept. Calories, sleep. Calories, sleep. So most athletes need 8 to 10 hours of sleep. Most of us need 7 to 8 hours of sleep. It depends. Now, some of you are wired to have a lot less than that, but there's not a lot of you that are out there like that. So ask your clients how much they sleep. And then obviously, you know, plan and logging is very helpful. Going on to different options of macronutrients, of what percentages, we can have a field day on what percentages each one of us should have. There's intermittent fasting, there's cycling, there's paleo, I'm sure. There's tons of other things we haven't put up there. But I pretty much work with different macros at different times, and I treat each person as an individual. I only have done intermittent fasting with two individuals, and that's because they had severe polycystic ovarian syndrome. I mean, the conditions were pretty serious. I'm not one that, and it was actually a doctor that I truly really respect, so he asked me if I would work with this person on intermittent fasting. So it kind of came from a doctor, not from me. And paleo is something you got to be cautious about because a lot of them, if you have an athlete or pretty active, sometimes they're not getting enough carbohydrates. So you just, that's where some of this, and taking anything out and so forth, it might cause some problems with some nutrients, but... Now, this was just one other testimonial of one of my clients where this was just somebody, she was a female, she was 46. She was working out hard, but she just wasn't having the right carbs at the right times, the right proteins at the right times. So we switched that, and literally in 6 or 8 weeks, she lost 6 pounds of fat and gained 3 pounds of muscle. And now that's a fun bod pod. Those are fun bod pod readings because, you know, she lost 3 more pounds of fat than she thought. And you guys, a pound of fat, and these are always nice to buy. Buy the 1 pound ones if you want, but you know, a pound of fat's this big. So when somebody loses a pound of fat, it's a big deal. A pound of muscle's this big. So she lost 6 of these and put on 3 of these. And I always tell people, you don't put a pound, like, a pound just doesn't pop on your bicep. And then pound, you know, bumps on your glutes because you did a lot of squats. They, you know, it spreads across the body because some females are like, I don't want to put on a lot of muscle. I'm like, oh my gosh. You got to put on a lot of muscle to be big, and you know, so getting over that myth of, okay, here's a pound of fat, and here's a pound of muscle, that's going to change your body shape. But she's just really excited because the only thing we changed was her nutrition composition. Her calories stayed the same, her workouts stayed the same. Now, medically, there are a lot of things that can become pretty complicated and possibly prevent the person from getting leaner. And with women, it is a lot more difficult to, we have a lot more issues that can get in the way. And so the first one is metabolic syndrome. Now, the things here I'm going to point out is I love people. If somebody's getting blood work, I love for them to get an HbA1c. I recommend you get an HbA1c. This is, usually they recommend this if you're type 1 or type 2 diabetic. But believe it or not, you know, when you're always trying to learn and you're trying to find out new situations, somebody needed help with the health fair. And I said, sure, I'll help. I don't normally do that, but they needed somebody to do readings for clients, and they were shorthanded. And they did HbA1cs, and it blew my mind away how many people, their employee base, had normal fasting blood sugar, but their HbA1c, which tells you what your blood sugars are 24 hours a day for the last 3 months, were above what they should be. And I'm like, oh my gosh, they're walking right into type 2 diabetes at some point if they don't reverse this. So this is actually almost a precursor to type 2 diabetes. So if you want it between 4.8 and 5.6. So I always get this because if I see that, hey, they're pretty healthy. If you have someone who's doing marathons and they're like, and they're a good body weight and they have a high HbA1c, wow, what's going on with insulin resistance there? And I've seen that happen. So don't underestimate whoever you see, because these are good numbers for all of us to work with. Because some of your athletes can have these issues, but they just don't know it because they train so much. But if you ask them what they're eating, a lot of times they're under eating by 1,000 calories a day, but that's maintenance for them. So they could be showing signs of polycystic ovarian syndrome and so forth. And this was just one person. This was a lady who was 34, 41% body fat. Remember, I like 30% or below. She was 25 pounds over ideal body, or, you know, over ideal body weight. But where I want to get you to is she was just diagnosed with type 2 diabetes. We got her down to 29%. She lost 100% body fat, and she didn't have the symptoms anymore. So sometimes you can actually reverse that. It's not always like type 2 has to be type 2. You can sometimes reverse this. So that was pretty powerful. Now, thyroid function, I can go into a whole presentation on thyroid function. It took me 8 years to find a specialist that I could finally work with that knew, like, could do thyroid, who could do hormones, who could do... I will tell you, endocrinologists are not usually the best doctors to go see because they're used to working with type 2 diabetes and cancer. If this person is not a thyroid specialist and work with people with thyroid problems all the time, then I would not see them for if you think you have a thyroid issue. I've had 10 people diagnosed with Hashimoto's, which is it's like me diagnosing you with type 1 diabetes. So that's a big oversight because of the labs that the doctors did not do and that they kept telling me things are wrong. I'm like, yeah, they're not right. And I'm agreeing with them, but they go, every doctor I've seen so far said I'm fine. I'm like, well, you're not fine. I send them to them, and they always come back. Not always, but most of the time they come back with something somebody overlooked. So if anybody comes back and they just do a TSH, I'm telling you that is not the specialist to see for thyroid. But 95% of the doctors that you go get a thyroid test saying to check the thyroid, they just do a TSH. And my thing is a red flag on, then just go to another person and ask them to do a TSH, a T4, a T3, a reverse T3, and TPO and thyroid globulin are antibodies. If they're off the chart, usually that means they have Hashimoto's. But most won't do those the TPO and the thyroid globulin, okay? And then you could have a really good TSH, but T4 converts to T3, so if that conversion isn't working right, then they might need assistance. And this is, again, where TSH is not your answer, so make sure you see the appropriate, and you can say, do you do a TSH? Not that they would do it, is are they doing it? Because this is where, now it doesn't solve your problem with them right away, like all of a sudden they start losing weight, but they'll start eventually to lose weight. And a lot of times with thyroid, I will sometimes do gluten-free, because some people can have sensitivities to the foods. We got adrenal function, and let me tell you, if you have a people who over-exercise, sometimes they can work their adrenals to the ground and have issues. We have pancreas function that could have some issues as well. Now, there are food allergies and there are food sensitivities. And so some people can be sensitive, but they don't technically have an allergy. So when I'm asking people, I'm like, do you have any food intolerance, food sensitivities, food allergies? I mean, this has gotten pretty complex when we talk with people. And again, it might be worthwhile. If you're sensitive, it doesn't mean you have to give it up. It just means sometimes if your gut's a little bit under inflammation that you need to pull away from those foods or you rotate them in. My problem is everybody's so high on wheat and dairy, which are the first two and most, like, the most common foods that have the most issues. But there are people out there that they don't have any wheat sensitivity, and we're telling them, take it out. And they don't need to, as long as it's within the parameters. So most common are chocolate, citrus, coffee, believe it or not, corn, dairy. You don't want a corn issue. If you thought wheat was bad, you don't want corn. I will share one thing is I did have somebody who had a corn sensitivity, and if you're trying to figure out what's wrong with you, sometimes, like, one instance is like fish oil, okay? If you get fish oil and it's encapsulated, you want that fish oil, the encapsulation basically, the capsule had corn in it, not the fish oil. And sometimes they coat a bottle with like cornstarch. This, so it's not gonna be on the food label. I did have one client who, they were telling me, well, when my kid eats like all these fruits, his mouth kind of gets itchy, but if he eats it frozen, he doesn't. And I go, I bet it's the pesticides or whatever they put on it. So I said, next time wash it and use the cleaner, and they didn't have a problem. So there's just interesting things you find. And Alcat's just one location. So everyday tips that are out there, breakfast, eat every 2 to 4 hours, 2/3 by 2/3 are fiber, are protein, varied macronutrients at different times. That I do recommend a professional assist, you know, you refer that out. Pre and post workouts, hydration, alcohol, stress, sleep, plan and log. And then this is just me, when people are talking, we should be striving for these nutrients through food. I did a big presentation on eye health, so I have a plethora of research that supports all this, but if we help our eyes, we help the rest. So aim for 3 to 5,000 IUs of vitamin A a day, and you can get that through food. So if you are logging on MyFitnessPal or SparkPeople, that's kind of what you want to aim. For vitamin C, you want to aim for 500 to 700 milligrams a day. For vitamin D3, you want at least 2,000 IUs of D a day, and you definitely need to get your labs drawn on that because most people are low. Aim for 400 IUs of vitamin E and D alpha tocopherol. That's when I do kind of recommend supplementation. I know Lisa was before talking about some people are doing too much. You can do too much, so it's knowing how much and what forms it needs to be. So D-alpha tocopherol is the most form that you want to get that in. Aim for 1,000 to 1,500 milligrams of calcium a day. Again, you can get that through food. But if you're not getting it through food, only 200 to 300 milligram tablets. Don't buy more. Your body will not absorb it. It's a waste. And calcium interferes with iron absorption. So if you have somebody who's taking an iron supplement, they can't take it with a calcium supplement. There has to be a 2-hour time window. Aim for 18 to 32 milligrams of iron a day. Aim for 15 milligrams of zinc a day. And then I gave just a little bit more grams per kilogram of DH or grams per kilogram of body weight of EPA, DHA, but to break it down, 500 to 1,000 milligrams of each a day. And then the next one is for eye health. So all of us, like 50% of us at some point will have cataract or glaucoma, believe it or not, if we live long enough for that to happen. So if you work with athletes, non-athletes, this is still really important. So you want so much lutein and zeaxanthin. And why do you want those two? Is because zeaxanthin is known as like the macular density nutrient because that's the only carotenoid that can go into the eye. Beta carotene, like vitamin A, like beta carotene, you hear about it, but it's a precursor to make vitamin A. So technically vitamin A helps the eye, but zeaxanthin and lutein are the only bioflavonoids that can actually get into the eyes, and they're very abundant, and so this is where it could help with that.